your courts with praise. You are eternal with no beginning or end. You made us, and you are working your purpose now in our world and in our lives. Know that the Lord is God. We praise you in this new year. We praise you that whatever the future holds, we know that it's held in your hand. The Lord is God, He made us, and we are His. Amen. If you can all stand, if you can, for the call to worship.
Good morning and welcome.
Good morning.
Attention. side where it says, consider your ways in the new year. The bold print. There are four questions on the bottom. What's the most important way you will, by God's grace, try to make this year different from the last year? Second, what's the single most important thing you can do to improve the quality of your life this year? stand out as something that is a bit mysterious. But look at it and consider it, and find out that it ties in to some remarks that were made just a few moments ago. When Fred was talking about the importance of the AsWeGather service, that we come to worship once a month together with each other, we find out that we're not alone in our suffering and in our bewilderments, but there's other people who are also coping, and they can come as encouragement. I would add to it that it's also companionship. All of us go through life, and we walk through life like a journey. And we find that there are some incredibly high points to that life. And there's things that happen to everybody. And there's also some pretty lousy things that come our way too. And when you experience all of that just alone, the isolation can be crushing. In fact, I found that sometimes when I'm having a tough time, the worst part of it is not the physical pain or the sense of loss that I experience, the disappointment itself, but it's the fact that that suffering kind of pushes me into a place of isolation and I'm alone. And that can be more unbearable than the pain of whatever it is that's going on. And to find out that I'm now alone at those moments becomes so unfortunate. Like somebody is not just taking that pain away from me. There's somehow we can't do that with each other. But the fact that somebody is walking along in that journey of mine at that moment gives me this companionship that is in itself. That is just incredible. We find out in the Christian faith that there's never a time that we're alone. Even when physically there's not other people around, that Jesus, who bore my sins and my suffering and my brokenness, died for me, is also alive to me, and is walking right alongside of me, is just incredible. And so we have this meal. You know, it's just a short meal, a little piece of bread, a little bit of juice that we share. And we call it, among other things, communion. It's really to name that companionship. That we are together. None of us are alone. We're walking through this life together. And among us is Jesus, who is always walking along with us and brings God right to our own doorstep all the time to be there with us through whatever's going on. The high points and the low points both. And so that's more than just the encouragement that was named earlier, which is so vital, so very important. But it also means that communion is with us. Now, a word about communion in the way that we practice it in our church. You also hear words attached to this meal, such as the Lord's Supper, or Eucharist, or in Roman Catholic, Episcopalian, and Eastern Orthodox traditions, it's often referred to as Mass. Mass means pardon. It means celebration. And there are all points of this meal in which we're brought into a kind of a visible communion with God. That's all that that means. Now, some churches will say this is only for people who believe just the same way that we believe and are official members of our church. We can be sure that you're in a place in your life that it's okay to receive this. In our church, among a number of others, not just United Methodist, but a number of other denominations, we call our community a meal that is done with an open table, which means that you don't need to be a member of the church. You might have a different take on what it all means and what God means to you, but the one thing that binds us together to make us available for this meal is that we know that Jesus is inviting us to come and take part in it. And that in addition to that if we believe in Jesus and hold that belief in our heart, Jesus is my Savior. chalice and little cups of wine. In our case, it means that it's not fermented. It's grape juice, and it's not fermented. That's been the case from Methodist all the way back to the 1890s, officially. And Methodist churches were practicing that back in the 1870s. So it's not fermented. And if that's a concern of yours, you can be easy with knowing that it's grape juice. And oftentimes we use gluten-free bread. We don't have gluten-free bread today, just so you know, it's wheat bread that you need there. And I'm going to make sure that my hands are good and clean. And I will be distributing the bread. We're going to have some help with folks holding these trays of little cups. And so when you come forward, if you just hold your hand out, palm up, I'm going to break a piece of the bread off of the loaf and I'm going to place it in your hand. And then please take a cup and you eat the bread and you take the cup and you sip out of it and drink that. And when you go back to your seats, just place it in the baskets that are placed in front of the sanctuary here. And you go back to your seats. So this involves some prayer and invitation and knowing that this ties us back to when Jesus celebrated a supper with his closest friends. And it turned out to be the last meal that he had before he was put together on the cross. So if you turn in the hymnals, that's the visual, to page 13, we're going to jump around the page just a little bit. So I'm sure that you can follow. And we'll just join together in offering this invitation and this prayer. The invitation. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him to earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Now, if you go over to page 13, we're going to start where it says the very beginning. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. So with your people on earth, and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord God, how heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, he gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery, sin, and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples as he broke it, and said, "Take this and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, and blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, and said, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. May them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and in peace at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit is your holy church. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father.
glad that Faith has led us in music on the piano. You might notice that Faith is new to that role in this setting for our AsWeGather service, because it's usually Neil Harris who is at the piano. Neil has been ill and has been admitted to the hospital. So as we enter into this time, the time of prayer, I invite you to keep him as a part of the list of those that you're praying for. Let's spend together this time of silent prayer for others and for ourselves. God, as we come to you in prayer, we remind you that you have your arms around us. A hole that is tight and comfortable and good and life-giving. Because of all that, we have thanks. We give ourselves to your hands. In Jesus' name, amen.
On this last day of the year, in our sanctuary, which is about to change, we want to also remember all the people we've lost. We also want to remember the ones that are not here: Michelle, Prud'homme, is away, and of course, you know, Paris, in the hospital. John Wesley, founder of the Methodist movement, succinctly described the plan of discipleship, what we call the general rules. As Christians, we are to do no harm by avoiding evil of every kind, do good to all people, and attend upon all the ordinances of God by participating in worship, taking communion, reading the Bible, and praying. John Wesley is also known for his tremendous work ethic. In the 1700s, when land travel was by walking, horseback, or by carriage, Wesley logged more than 4,000 miles per year. During his lifetime, he preached about 4,000 sermons. Wesley could give today's experts lessons in efficiency. He was a natural organizer and approached everything diligently, especially with the need. It was at Oxford University in England that he and his brother Charles participated in a Christian club in such an orderly manner that critics called them Methodists, a title which they gladly embraced. John Wesley preached throughout the British Isles. Never wanted to waste time, he discovered that he could read while walking, or on horseback, or even in his carriage. Nothing stopped him. Wesley pushed on through rainstorms and blizzards, and if his coach got stuck, he continued on horse or on foot. To strengthen the Methodist work in the colonies, John Wesley sent two of his lay preachers, Richard Gordon and Joseph Whitmore, to America in 1759. The reason I bring up John Wesley is AsWeGather is 12 months old, and we're growing. Every month we see members of our own church and members from the outside community join us. We're open for all. And as you read in your bulletin, you'll see three different journal entries over a 10-year period by John Wesley. We're not going to read them today, but you'll read that when you have time. But each year, every few years when he wrote these journal entries, he commented on his his congregation getting bigger and bigger. Thus became Methodist. So as the AsWeGather service continues, we also want to bring our growth into 2016. So I invite and I encourage all of you in our January AsWeGather service to bring someone with you. Friend, a relative, bring someone. Let them share what we're sharing today. I find great comfort when I pray. I'm talking to Jesus and Father. During moments of indecision, moments of pain, moments of joy and laughter, our prayers are heard. We pray for family, we pray for friends, we pray for loved ones who are no longer with us. Is there anyone you'd like us to pray for?
Pray for my nephew Tracy, who is suffering from viral meningitis.
I'd also like to add my prayers to Neil Harris once again. We can all again take a moment to pray for Neil Harris, Sandra Green, covering oral surgery for the homeless, for Lisa, for Donnie Britson, for Tracy, for everyone here today. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we commit ourselves to follow your word in every situation that we face. We trust that you are our answer to our prayers. Please watch over all of us, especially today, New Year's Eve, and all the people who we pray for. We pray for Christians worldwide. We pray for those who have not yet discovered the AsWeGather service. And we pray for all the volunteers to help with the sack lunch monthly program. We continue to pray for a growing rebirth and the continued leadership of our church by Reverend Mike. I believe that you know everything that I need, Lord. I rely upon you in advance for your presence in every circumstance that comes my way. Make us worthy, Lord, to serve those people throughout our community who live, suffer, and die in poverty and hunger. Give them to our hands this day your daily bread. And by our understanding, give them love, give them hope, and give them peace and joy. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. You can open up your hymnals to a prayer number 607. This is one of the things that Neil wanted to do, so we're going to continue in his absence. He cited the group, the covenant prayer, in the Wesleyan tradition. Number 607. I am no longer my own, but God.
Put me to what thou wilt. Grant me to whom thou wilt. Put me to doing. Put me to suffering.
life to you. Now, if we can stand for the benediction. God is the eternal rock from year's beginning to its end. God is faithful, and each day God is present. In each action, God comes close for all eternity. God is trustworthy, yesterday, today, and forever. Sustaining, enlightening, making all things new, God is the eternal rock. The last words of John Wesley on his deathbed, best of all, God is with us. In Jesus' name, amen. If you can remain seated, our choir will be singing, and we'll ask you to remain until the service. So we meet again on January 28th. Go in peace. Happy New Year. Thank you.